On today's show,
we discuss the top of the East and predict some super early All-Star snubs.
What did LeBron and Wade do to earn the Worst of the Week designation?
And the Big Cat makes an appearance in our top 10 plays from the past 7 days.
It's Friday, November 11th. The starter starts now. Ow!
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters, whether you're joining us live right now on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube. We're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tess Mellis.
I love you whether you like it or not.
To his right, the international man of mystery, taking it to the stash, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele.
Lele, and last, certainly not least, over there, it's the bearded one. That's Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
TK, what do you got, bud?
Guys, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag TheStarters, and I think there's something wrong with Kevin Durant's shoes because he lost one again last night. It's now happened in back-to-back games and at least 3 times already this season. This isn't a new problem either. You can go on YouTube and find clips from years ago of Durant playing in just one shoe. I don't know exactly what's going on, but it brings us to today's question. Why does Kevin Durant keep losing his shoes? To me, there's only one logical answer, and that's that he has tiny baby feet. I don't know how he'd ever keep his shoes on, but it would definitely explain why they're always falling off. It's like my 2-year-old trying to put on my shoes. They're not gonna work, Isla. Nonetheless, we wanna hear from you, so let us know on Twitter. Why does Kevin Durant keep losing his shoes? Use hashtag TheStarters, and we'll hear from you later.
All right, get those tweets in. Before we get officially started here, a happy Veterans Day / Remembrance Day to all who have served or are currently serving to protect our country's U.S., Canada, Australia, which includes, I'm happy to say, former Marine, 91 to 95, I believe, but current Kick-Ass Starters cameraman, Todd Crow. Can we see him back in the dark? I don't know if it's possible.
That's
but
him
Todd,
laughing in the back there.
Yeah, that's him laughing. He's working that jib right now. Yeah, give it up. Thank you, Todd.
Hey, you're the man, Todd.
He kicks.
There he is.
Got a little light on.
Thanks for wearing an orange hat. Makes it easier to see you.
Yeah, good stuff. All right, so we've got the top 10 plays, we've got Worst of the Week, but we're starting with a little fill in the blank here, which is pretty self-explanatory. Trey's gonna throw some, you know, statements at us with an open spot, and we'll fill in the blank. TK.
All right, our very first topic, Dwayne Wade returned to Miami last night to play against the Heat for the first time in his career. He was welcomed back with raucous cheers, a touching video tribute, and most importantly, a sweet, sweet Bulls win. Guys, fill in the blank. Dwayne Wade's Miami homecoming last night was blank.
What do we got?
For me, it was fair.
I go with perfect.
Perfect.
I went with Dwayne Javu.
Excuse me?
Dwayne Javu. Like deja vu.
Yeah, no, I got the deja vu.
I won't get it unless you say it for a fifth time.
Why do you say that?
Because even though he didn't have a great game shooting the ball, only 5 of 17, he made 2 huge free throws at the end of the game and he got his team the win. He's won in that building so many times. He's always called it his house. And when the game had to be won last night, Dwayne won the game, even though he's playing for the opponent.
It wasn't sexy enough to be a Dwayne Wade game.
Yeah, but the last
few years, he shot 5 for 17, 13 points. He was disappointed. He said it was weird. It was weird shooting out there. It was weird being in the uniform. He didn't look like Dwayne Wade to me most of the night.
I think the homecoming was perfect. I don't care about the box score and his stat line. I'm more addressing how the fans welcomed him back. And that to me was perfect. You know, the introductions, he gets the last call, the Dwayne Wade, everyone goes crazy. Then there's the 2-minute montage at the end of the first timeout there. Standing ovation, like we expected, and rightfully so.
Yeah, that's why it was fair to me, because everybody played it right. They cheered at the right times. The organization was also fair with their video tribute. Pat Riley was fair, finally communicating with Dwayne Wade with an email.
He hasn't read it yet, though.
He's playing a basketball game. He couldn't have read it. But it wasn't perfect because Dwayne Wade didn't hit game winner.
It was perfect because then they booed Dwayne Wade as well. When Wade went to hit those free throws, how did he get to the free throw line?
Yeah, with a foul.
By selling a little bit of a foul. Yeah, there is a late game. It's a tight game. He gets on the sidelines there. Winslow touches him, bumps him, but Wade sells it. And the crowd, after giving him a warm welcome back, they boo him because they're trying to win a basketball game. They're cheering for the Heat.
I think they're booing the officials because it was a questionable call.
But they were continuing to boo when Wade was at the line trying to shoot. And I love it. It's perfect.
We've seen that from Wade in Miami for so many years. You know, close game, gets tied at the end. He gets a call, goes to the free throw line, knocks him down.
So what did this just said to you? Dwayne deja vu. I can't
exactly.
even say that.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, for a Miami game, Dwayne Wade was the one who closed it out.
Right.
How many times have you seen that in your life? Millions. Maybe billions.
That's okay. That was perfect. Again, yeah. And I'm happy that, of course, the Miami faithful there gave him the standing O. And then,
yep.
And then when the game was on the line, they booed him. That's how it should go.
That was a good flop. Really good flop. He sold it so well.
He really did. All right, Trey, next one.
Yeah, moving on. Everyone agrees that the Cavaliers are the class of the Eastern Conference. But after that, it's anyone's guess. Is it the Raptors, the Hawks, the Hornets, somebody else? Fill in the blank. The second best team in the Eastern Conference is blank.
This is tough.
Yeah, very tough.
This is tough. I'm going Hawks.
It's hard to fit on here, but I went with Toronto.
What do we mean?
That's how us Torontonians pronounce it. Toronto. That's a double N-O, but like, there's no room on this baby.
It was like Chris Broussard spelling Memphis. and you go Hornets.
I'm
so we all
Hornets.
Disagree. We all disagree.
You're ready for that, Joe. Oh, boy, you're ready for that, Joe. Somebody has to take the throne from the Raps as the second best team. I know the Hornets have started well, but they've had a bit of a cupcake of a schedule. Their best win was against Utah at home. No George Hill in the opposing lineup. No Alec Burks, no Boris Diaw. This is the Raps' title to lose, I still believe. They won 57 games last year. They haven't started incredibly well at 5-2, but this is still their title, I believe. I still think they have enough to beat the Hornets tonight. We shall see as they play them tonight for the second-place title.
I'm not taking last season into account when I make this pick with the Charlotte Hornets. I'm just going on what we've seen so far, and their last win against Utah was their most impressive.
Yeah.
Again, they came back. And they're doing it on the defensive end, which is what Steve Clifford has been working on in his 3 and a bit seasons in charge of Charlotte. They've got the second best D in the league, and Roy Hibbert is going to come back soon. And we know that he's not maybe the all-star he was a couple of years ago, but he's still a very, very good internal defender. If they can make sure their perimeter defense maintains its stance, I think the Hornets are going to be a tough team to beat all season long.
If you're telling me that their presence in the second spot hangs on Roy Hibbert's defense, then there's a problem.
I didn't say that.
They're good, obviously. They're very, very good. I just worry about their offense a little bit. Never worried about their defense. They have grown so much in the camaraderie they've had. Just the chemistry they've had is also showing already.
Kemba Walker is having an all-star season.
Oh,
he's
absolutely.
A closer. He's putting up great numbers. You only need to have that one guy.
You need one guy?
No, you only need to have that one guy who's a superstar.
Their offense is middle of the pack. Their offense is middle of the pack.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Here's the thing. The truth is this. I mean, you got the Hornets, you got the Raptors, I got the Hawks. This is very likely going to change every week here. If we did this question every week until the end of the season, I could see you could make a case probably for one of these teams. Maybe the Celtics get back into play. Maybe the Bulls jump up there. I go with the Hawks right now because they've had some impressive wins over the last little stretch. They beat the Rockets. They beat the Cavs. They beat the number one team in the East.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Raptors didn't do that. The Hornets, I don't believe, have had a chance yet. That's where I sort of lean towards Atlanta right this second. Yeah, the second place crown in the East, it really is the Raptors, and someone does eventually have to take it. But the Hawks have been great. I think it's Atlanta. You know, a top 10 defense, a top 10 offense, a top 3 defense. They play at a fast pace. You've talked about Dwight Howard nonstop here on the show. They're good. Hawks are good, man.
I haven't talked about it nonstop.
You talk about Dwight Howard all the time, man.
I get asked about him, yeah. Oh, he's playing well.
All right, Trey, final one.
All right, our final topic on our podcast, The Drop, today. We talked about early season successes who, quote unquote, might have the numbers but won't make this season's All-Star game. Need y'all to fill in the blank here. The biggest name to miss the All-Star game will be blank.
Ooh.
This is a tough call this early in the season.
I'm writing a lot here. Who are you going with, guys? Clay Tomo. Okay.
Yeah, didn't have room for Thompson.
You're going Clay too.
Oh, you're going Clay. Wow, yeah. Shocking. Tomo.
I'm cheating a little bit, but I'm going with one of the Wolves, Towns or Wiggins.
Oh, cheater.
Yeah.
Yeah, rough start for the Wolves is going to cost them.
Yeah, there's no way two are making it.
No.
And both of these guys have unbelievable numbers. And we expected Karl Anthony Towns to be a lock for the All-Star game for the next 10, 11, 12
mm-hmm.
years.
Mm-hmm.
And his numbers are there, like I said, but you got to win in this conference. I mean, if you look at the it's nuts. Your guards are going to be Curry, Westbrook, Harden, CP3, or Lillard, right?
Yep.
Those are your 5 guards. Your forwards, tell me if I'm wrong, Kawhi, Durant, probably Anthony Davis, even despite the Pelicans mm-hmm. not winning a lot of games, Blake Griffin, and Cousins is very likely going to get in, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that leaves 2 wild card spots. I haven't even mentioned Draymond Green, who I think the coaches, and he's been there before, of course, and they respect, especially if the Warriors are good. And that's one spot left for guys like Hayward, Towns, McCollum, Clay. I mean, there are so many guys. There are going to be a lot of guys on the outside looking in, come all
yeah. celebrate. And that's yeah. why I've got Clay as one of the odd men out.
It's a good pick. It's
if the Warriors have a good record and they get three All-Stars, as you mentioned, Steph, Kevin Durant, and then Draymond Green, then I just don't think there's quite enough room there for Clay, especially because Clay's gotten off to a slow start. His numbers are down from last year. He's shooting only 28% from three-point range, and there's still plenty of time, but I just think that the Warriors probably won't get four. It's not unprecedented that a team gets four All-Stars, but it is rare.
Yeah, when you look at an All-Star roster, you get five guards, possibly a six. Last year in the Western Conference, you had five guards. Mm-hmm. As you said, Curry, Russ, Harden, Locks, yeah. CP3, Lock. Damian Lillard's not missing the All-Star game again.
No,
so there's five guys right there. So Clay is just sort of a process by, or what's the word here?
Process by elimination.
That sounds really weird. It sounds really weird.
I mean,
comes
look,
out
he
of
started off slowly last year, and he made it. And he made the All-NBA team as well. But just this year, I think things are different because you've got Kevin Durant there this year. Yeah. He's automatically in with Steph. Do they get Draymond? Do they even get three in there this year?
Yeah. This is Friday. We just can't talk on Friday.
Yeah, we're stumbling and mumbling.
Yeah, it's been a long week.
But it's going to be the Wolves. And I think you make a case for CJ McCollum, too. I don't think two Blazers is asking a lot. And his numbers are unbelievable.
There's five spots for guards. Those guys are locks. Curry, Russ, CP3, Westbrook, and Dame. Those five are locks. Six is going to be tough.
Talking about the All-Star game already.
Yeah.
Gotta love them. Okay. Gotta take a break. When we come back, Tass's worst of the week. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome back to the show. Now's the point of the week where we hand out the dishonor to someone in the NBA family that has done wrong in the eyes of the starters. It's time for the worst of the week.
Ladies and gentlemen, the worst of the week.
This week's worst of the week is a duo. The dishonor goes to both LeBron James and Dwayne Wade. Now, you may remember the two made a wager on the World Series. Loser would have to wear the full baseball uniform of the opposing fella's hometown team to their upcoming game. So when the Cavs travel to visit the Bulls December 2nd, Bron should enter the arena sporting full Cubs gear. Here's where the worst part comes in. When Wade was asked about the bet this week, he said, "We've been talking. My stylist has been talking to his stylist." Huh? So my stylist has been talking to his stylist. They actually had a conversation before game 7 to get the sizes of whoever loses. It's got to fit right in everything. It's funny because I got a picture of different uniforms of like which one you think he should wear of the Cubs uniforms. See, that's what's wrong in today's NBA. Stylists are talking to each other, our friends off the court. Back in my day, stylists would never get together to form a super outfit. That's as soft as a fleece sweater. Can't believe this. Bron and Wade, your worst of the week.
And their stylists.
I guess so.
Yeah, I guess.
It's a bet. A bet's a bet.
LeBron, worst of the week, 2 weeks running here.
Yeah, it's got some bad juju.
Wow, I'm saying, man, it's crazy.
We also have a backup runner-up worst of the week.
Okay.
The Boston Celtics, they can't rebound. It's getting so bad that guys are rebounding against them on their backs.
Oh, wow.
They're last in the league in rebound percentage, last in the league in defensive rebound percentage because of plays like this. Against the Wizards on Wednesday, the Wizards had 19 offensive rebounds. Boston had 24 defensive rebounds. That's gross.
You're discrediting Bradley Beal's offensive rebounding ability. Yeah, I mean, that makes you worst of the week.
Jared Johnson tapped to him.
Yeah.
Get healthy, Bradley.
Grab it to him. All right, there it is. Two worst of the week for the price of one. We got to take a break. When we come back, it's the starters' top 10 plays from the past 7 days. Another great collection of NBA highlights. Don't go anywhere.
Daly always had a saying about NBA coaching. He said, the head coach's job in the NBA is basically like an airline pilot. And his number one job at the end of the season is to safely land the plane.
Wind is now 200 at 4, runway 21 clear to land.
Okay, 21 clear to land.
Okay, Catch the season premiere of Beyond the Paint tonight at 11 p.m. Eastern here on NBA TV. Rick Carlisle flying there. I thought you always wanted to fly, right?
Yeah, I'd love to go up with him.
Yeah, you want to do a fighter jet, though.
Yeah, mine would be a bit more extreme than that. But,
yeah, extreme.
Yeah, start off there with him.
Yeah, well, you got a stash like that. You got to fly a fighter jet. All right, it's time for the... Yeah, there it is. We can't find our cameraman out there, but we got a camera on that stash 24-7, baby. All right, let's get to the top 10 plays of the week. It's a good one. At number 10, watch this. The big man, Hassan Whiteside, on the fast break all alone.
Oh, man.
Runs down the double pump reverse like Harold Miner.
Yeah. You don't see that from 27 footers.
That's unbelievable.
More big men throwing it down. Giannis Antetokounmpo, yeah, he's a winger, but he's almost as tall as Hassan Whiteside. He's throwing the two-handed windmill.
Jordan-esque. Jordan-esque there.
Alphabet causing some wind.
Jordan to the actual.
Oh, I love this shot.
Yes, let's slow her down.
Oh, yeah. Rock that. Get that tongue out next time, Yanni.
Yeah, for sure. At number 8, Grizzlies down 1, 0.7 left. Gotta be something creative and quick. Marc Gasol on the paint. What a play for the game winner.
Look at those hops.
Yeah. Oh, come on, Lee. Oh, and the pylon.
Perfect pass, Vince.
Yeah, that is a gorgeous play there.
At number 7, Dennis Schroeder and Paul Millsap. Watch this. Paul Millsap, this is the highlight, right? A great pass.
What
is that?
Finish.
Whoa. Oh, yeah, it's the old give and go. Yeah, sure. That's how it
really
works.
Really go.
Dennis Schroeder looking at the left hand after that.
Look at that
pass.
Is that a loud tussie?
What's that?
To look at the left hand.
Yeah, that's legal. That's legal.
You don't see this often. The chase down alley-oop block.
Oh, get it.
Miles Turner for the, I believe, second week running here, making the top 10 with a defensive play. Get out of here, Sir Robert Covington.
You've been dethroned.
He was just trying to Sir Rock the rim. It didn't work out. At number 5, the Steph Curry dancing three. Look at this. You think he loses the ball? No.
He was already running back to. So
look, I'm convinced he loses the ball on purpose. He's gonna lose it. Come get it. And I'll shoot it in your eye. He's that good at it.
He's like, yeah, if I lose it on purpose, maybe I'll make the top 5 of the starters' top 10 here. What a shot. That is not fair. At number 4, the Moose, Mike Muscala, coming baseline with the putback dunk.
Oh, no.
And then the fall. Wow.
The dunk is great.
Yeah.
Look, I'm throwing it out here. Oh. Is this the best white guy dunk since Tom Chambers used Mark Jackson as a trampoline?
It might be.
It's in play.
Yeah.
At number 3, Karl-Anthony Towns throws it down on Brooke Lopez. Oof. That is a huge, another 7-footer with a monstrous jam.
And the ball boinks off Brooke's face at the end, too. Oh.
Kathmandu.
Get out of the way, Brooke Lopez.
A lot of big guys in this top 10. Rudy Gobert over Kristaps Porzingis. And I mean over. He meant
4 inches in play.
Yeah, look how high the ball is. And he's not left-handed. That's nuts.
So many dunks on this top 10. Number 1 play, Larry Nance getting up.
He puts his hand on David West's head.
Just caresses his head.
Yeah.
Almost palms his face.
Oh. That's nice. That's real nice. Real nice form on that.
And they're rocking those Lakers throwbacks. You gotta love that. Oh, there's the camera. Yeah, stash.
Hello.
Oh, please stop that.
Hey, man. All right. When we come back, we'll see that stash again. And Lili's very solid play. It's coming in nice. Back with the starters. Kevin Durant lost his shoe again last night. He keeps losing them during games here. So we asked you, why does he keep losing his shoes? You've hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Trey, you have a few of the best answers.
Yeah, some good ones. Z Cutler says he's intentionally losing his shoes. Just wants to slide across the hardwood like Tom Cruise in Risky Business. Is that one of his top 5 movies? We'll never know. Marco says Westbrook put banana peels inside his shoes. I guess that's possible. Giorgio says, because he's got lizard feet, if you know what I mean. Nope. I don't know what you're
talking about.
Nobody knows what you mean, man. Lil Dill says KD keeps losing his shoes because he left his laces in OKC. Yes, it's possible. And Derek says he needs Tass Mellis to show him the heel lock.
You're so right.
Yeah, it's gotta lock it in.
It's an easy lacing technique.
Do we have a shoe?
Gotta do it.
I mean, can you show us? I mean, we got a shoe here very quickly.
Is it possible? This is a 24-hour show, right? We got lots of time.
No, I'm just
no, okay, I can't do it. I can't do it with this.
Why?
Too much pressure.
No, these eyelets aren't right.
Oh, man. Last night's pick and payoff was the Bulls in the Heat. I took the Heat. They lost. So congrats to you guys on the Bulls pick. I'm in trouble. Look, I'm in trouble here for the month of November. At the end of it all, whoever's in last place does the pick and payoff. You've seen all the fun we've done before. It's looking like it's gonna be me. I needed that game. I really needed that game last night. So if you have a suggestion out there for a payoff that I should do come the end of November, let me know. Hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Tonight's game, it's the Raptors and the Hornets, the battle for second place in the Eastern Conference.
The Raptors are leading right now, Skeets, as we record. They're up 6, 22-16.
That's good to hear. Lee, the only one with the Hornets. Lee, where are we going for the very solid play?
To Denver, and it's another one from the Warriors. Check out Iggy with his beautiful feed down to Klay Thompson with a nice finish. I think we've seen this before in the very solid play this season, but we'll see it again. There it is. Nice finish, beautiful layup. That's what I call a very solid play.
Very solid play, very solid mustache, Lee. Guys, please continue to donate to Lee's Movember page. Go to Movember.com, search for Lee Ellis. All right, over 2,100.
Yeah, we're doing it.
Trying to get to 10K. Can we get another look at that stash, though? Because, Lee, some people are saying you're looking like a guy named Big Merv.
There he is.
Real Big Merv.
Who's Big Merv?
That's Uncle Merv Hughes, a former Australian fast bowler.
Take off your glasses. You sort of look like him. Guys, we recorded the drop this morning. Had a whole lot of fun. Here's a short clip about mascots. If you were a mascot, what would you do to get the crowd all riled up?
Well, I'd take my head off to reveal a smaller head.
Oh, you can't.
And then I'd walk out of my outfit to reveal a smaller body.
Oh. That would work, though, because people would expect it to be your head, your human head under there. But
Then I'd reveal a smaller mascot body under there, too.
I'm just sorry.
Yeah, exactly.
Wait, and then you take that off and a smaller head?
Ooh.
If we can pull it off, yeah.
There, that is. Catch the drop, guys. Clippers Thunder tonight on the network. Coverage starts at 7:30.
This is the basis of the heel lock, people. A loop on either side. We're building a loop, and then we're locked in, baby. We're locked.
Oh, yeah.
Brace the weekend, people. Lock that in.
This is my shoe.
My shoe?
John Schumann.